For those of us who know the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior, we have, as the scriptures say, been born again. The best days are ahead of us. Now, that's not because we are good or smart. It is, of course, because of God's grace in our lives that He has taken us out of the kingdom of darkness, as the book of Colossians says, and have placed us into the kingdom of His dear Son. And this is not to say that in this life we don't have some pleasant times and good experiences. After all, James tells us that every good gift, every perfect gift comes down from the Father. And we're thankful for that which the Lord does in our lives in so many ways. My wife and I almost daily just contemplate just what the Lord has done in our lives. And we're not deserving of it, but He is such a good Father. And so we are very thankful for it and for His gifts and for Him and for our Savior. But it is also true that life is tough. Life is filled with pain and disappointments, fractured relationships, changes that occur, things we never signed up for, with diseases and financial setbacks and all of the kinds of things that we have experienced. There's nobody in this room who's been exempt from these things. They take different forms, but we are not exempt from them. The good news is that this is not all that there is. If this life was all that there was, then Solomon in the book of Ecclesiastes is right on target when he says, in essence, life is a bad joke. But life is not a bad joke. For those of us who have placed our faith in the Lord Jesus, we have an incredible future. And the scriptures tell us about it, but I have found that I believe one of the reasons why believers don't really anticipate what lies ahead is partly because some things are just not clear about what lies ahead. We talk about heaven. We talk about the kingdom of God. We talk about the millennium. We talk about the eternal kingdom and all of these kinds of things, and we aren't quite sure necessarily where all of them fit because they are not the same thing at all. And as I was thinking about you folks at Bayside, knowing that you have been given good teaching over the years, I also realize that sometimes we still don't quite have a handle on certain things. And we want to, among other things today, we want to take a look at what Jesus' kingdom is going to be like. And the purpose is not to just have a sort of pie in the sky approach to life, but recognize that all of these things have been given to us to primarily shape the way we live life right now. That when we come and become aware of what lies ahead for us, we really do prioritize life differently. We make different kinds of decisions, different kinds of choices. We invest differently. We live differently. When we come to, number one, understand what the scriptures say, what lies ahead for us, but number two, we believe it and we operate according to it. Some of this that we're going to talk about this morning is familiar to us, but I hope that for those that it's very familiar, that it will be nevertheless a refresher to your heart, to your soul, to your mind. The scriptures tell us a number of things about what lies ahead in relationship to the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. In your outline, we have a number of these down and written down, and you have them there. My hope is that that little piece of paper might prove to be an area or a piece of paper that you'll use to maybe study, go over, investigate the scriptures involved. In the book of Daniel, and again, you don't need to turn here, but one of the things that Daniel was given was an outline of man's kingdoms. And one of the things he is absolutely clear about is that man's kingdoms will continue on until one event occurs, and that is what we call the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when he comes back, this is what Daniel 2:44 says. And in the days of those kings, and in the context, he's referring to the end of man's kingdoms, the last days. We might refer to the Antichrist's kingdom. That's what he's really talking about. In the days of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which will never be destroyed. And that kingdom will not be left for another people. That is, it's not going to be taken over by some other group of people, some order of beings, angels or men. But God's kingdom will crush and put to an end all of the kingdoms of man, but it will itself endure forever. Now, fundamentally, there are two things that are being told here. That Christ's kingdom is not established until he comes back at the second coming and he destroys all of man's kingdoms. In other words, the kingdoms of man and the kingdom of Jesus Christ, what we call the messianic kingdom, do not coexist. Now, the majority within Christendom today says that Christ is king right now and he is ruling. He is not ruling right now. He is not king in the messianic sense. Now, he's the king of creation, as Psalm says, but that's not the coming kingdom. The kingdom of Christ is only established when he returns. He put the chronology this way when he said, but when the Son of Man, this is Matthew 25:31, when the Son of Man comes in his glory, which is obviously a reference to his second coming, and all the angels with him, then he will sit upon his glorious throne. There is simply no question that there is an order of events, and it is the second coming, terminating all of man's kingdoms. And at that point in time, the future kingdom of God, which is an eternal kingdom, is in fact established or set up. And that's what we want to take a look at today. What lies ahead for us? But when we talk about the future kingdom of God, I have found in talking with, whether it's been my students over the years or a lot of folks, that they confuse this with heaven. And heaven and the future kingdom of God are not the same thing. And we'll explain why. Heaven is the future for all believers temporarily. And we will go to heaven through one of two ways, either through death or at the event which we call the rapture. But in either case, we spend at least a minimum of 7 years in heaven. But that's not the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is on the earth, and it lasts for probably eternity. So we, as believers in the Lord Jesus, our future is clear and it is sure. For each of us who know Christ as our Savior, heaven is what lies ahead of us. It could be at the moment of Christ's return in the clouds to meet us in the air, where we go to be with him in the Father's house, and we experience the events that are talked about in Revelation 19. Or if that event doesn't come first, but death does, then we have a wonderful promise, don't we? Death is not going through, there is no such thing as the valley of the shadow of death. You don't go down some long, dark corridor at death. Paul is very clear. There's only two places that you can be as a believer, here or with the Lord. If you're not with the Lord, then you're here. If you're not here, then you're with the Lord. There's no third option. Instantaneously, immediately, the moment we draw our last breath, we are with Christ. We are in his presence, and we can only imagine what that will be like. Paul went there when he got stoned to death in Asia Minor, and he records it in 2 Corinthians chapter 12 that it is not permitted for men to speak about what that looks like. But he was there, and he tells us that it's just indescribable. So later on, he said to those same group of people, the eye has not seen and ear has not heard. It has not entered into the heart of man what God has prepared for those who love him. And so those are great days that are ahead of us. But when we look at the past heaven, and when Jesus comes back at his second coming, the church, the body of Christ, you and I who know him as Savior, return with him to the earth. And at that point in time, he will establish the messianic reign. Daniel 2 tells us, as does Isaiah 66 and others, that God's kingdom is a forever kingdom. That is, it's never going to be supplanted by Satan, by men. Never again will that happen. It is eternal. It is to the forever. But it is also true that we discover from the New Testament that there are actually two distinct phases to the kingdom of God. Future. When Christ comes back at his second coming, Jesus establishes what we call the millennial kingdom. The messianic kingdom is, I think, a better title because we have it greatly enumerated and elaborated in the Old Testament. Its characteristics, which is kind of what we want to look at today. It is then followed by the eternal kingdom of God. The messianic kingdom is on this present earth. The earth that we are residing on right now is going to be changed dramatically by a number of events, but it is still the same earth. And that's necessary because God made covenant promises to Abraham and his descendants, promises that have to be executed in the actual land itself. It can't be executed in heaven and fulfill the covenant. It can't be executed on a new earth. It's got to be on the present earth if God is going to fulfill his covenant promises. And so Jesus will reign for 1,000 years. We know that's the case because Revelation chapter 20 mentions 6 times that the kingdom of Jesus, the messianic age, will last for 1,000 years. The Old Testament prophets don't tell us that. That is the Apostle John's one contribution to the study of the kingdom. Then, after that is over, when God has fulfilled his covenant promises, the covenant promises that the Son of David would sit and rule upon the throne of David, when that is fulfilled, then the old earth is destroyed. A new heaven and new earth is created in which the Trinity rules. Now, in 1 Corinthians, Paul talks about the transition into this new age. And this is what he says in 1 Corinthians 15. Verse 23, but each in his own order, Christ the first fruit. He's talking about the resurrection. After that, those who are Christ's at his coming. Then comes the end. The end of what? Well, the end of his rule. When he delivers up the kingdom to the God and Father, when he has abolished all rule and authority and power, for he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy that will be abolished is death. And so at the end of the messianic age, right at this point in time, you have the final resurrection that Revelation 20 talks about. And for the first day, time since the days of Cain and Abel, there are no dead bodies anywhere on the earth. Death has been completely conquered at last. And when that happens, that's the last enemy. He then will turn all things over to the Father, to the Trinity. Now, what he is doing is merging the messianic kingdom into the eternal kingdom. In Revelation chapter 22 and verse 3, you have a statement that reads this way, "There shall no longer be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and his bondservant shall serve him." But the phrase, "the throne of God and of the Lamb," indicates that Jesus, in a sense, is still ruling, but it's now not as the preeminent one. In the messianic kingdom, he's the preeminent one. But he's going to merge that into the eternal kingdom, which will be on the new earth. And so probably it is inaccurate for us to say that we're going to live in heaven with Jesus forever. Our time in heaven apparently will be limited to whenever the second coming happens, but eternity apparently is spent here on the new earth. So, why? Well, what it does, it goes back to the original creation. God created man in his own image. That is, man had intellect, emotions, and will. And God created man uniquely that way for a number of reasons. One, so that man could worship and fellowship with God. Worship requires intelligence. Worship requires decision-making. We choose to obey. We choose to worship God. And so God made man with that capacity. He also made man, remember, as king and queen of the planet. He gave them dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, and so on. And man's great significance in relationship to creation is that he is a ruler. And the third thing that occurred is that God placed man in an absolutely perfect environment. He called it Eden, and it was a plot of the earth. It wasn't the entire earth, but it was intended to expand as the human race expanded. And he gave us bodies, physical bodies. Why? So that we could appreciate all that he had created, our senses. And so we know how that what happened, though, and that is that Adam and Eve made a horrible choice, and they chose to disobey God, and they lost everything in a moment of time, and the element called sin entered the world. God at that point in time apparently had a choice to make. The choice was, let's destroy everything and start over again, or not. Well, if he had done that, that would have been no big deal. I mean, he would have lost 6 days' work and two people, and, you know, 8 days later, you could be up and running again with a whole new universe. But God didn't do it that way, and I'm sure there are many reasons why, but he chose to embark upon the story of restoration and reconciliation. Why? Well, because the original idea was really good. That's why. Plan A was excellent. And so what we find then, as we look at the last three chapters of the Bible, is that the very things that were lost in Eden are now regained and actually enhanced, so that man now has a complete unhindered fellowship with God as his children, not just as his creation. There's a great emphasis upon Jesus being king, but Jesus himself put a great emphasis on giving rulership back to mankind again. This is why the book of Daniel emphasizes that Jesus, Messiah, is Son of Man, and ruling authority in Daniel 7 is given to him as Messiah. And Jesus then is clear that to faithful believers, there will be this opportunity to partner with him in his kingdom and rule. And then we discover that paradise is going to be restored. So the story of Scripture is the story of God's restoring and reconciling everything that was lost and actually enhancing it. The key event, of course, was when God became flesh and dwelt among us in order to pay for the one issue that needed to be paid for, and that was sin. And when that's taken care of, then it is possible for us to go back to plan A again. The cross had to take place before you have Jesus coming back and establishing this kingdom. So it isn't a foreign idea that life will be spent in full fellowship with God, with rulership, and with all kinds of activities in a paradise. That was the original idea, and that's where we are headed. That's why the best days are ahead of us. So it is good for us to have some understanding of what this kingdom of Messiah will be like. Going to have to walk through this kind of quickly, but one of the reasons why I took time and put all this stuff down is that I think you will be encouraged by what the scriptures say, what lies ahead for us. And then there's two things we need to deal with at the end. When we look at our earth, it's hard for us to understand because it's not the way things are now. But there's going to be a tremendous change that will take place when the Lord Jesus comes back again. The curse was placed upon man and upon the earth in Genesis chapter 3. But the Apostle Paul talks about what is going to take place when you and I, as believers, are fully and completely redeemed at the return of Christ. Paul says, I consider that the sufferings of this present time, and by the way, he simply emphasizes what we know is true, that life is tough. Life has disappointments. Life has pain. Life has burdens. But this is what he says, I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that is to be revealed to us, what our experience is going to be in the future. For the anxious longing of the creation waits eagerly for the revealing of the sons of God. The creation was subject to futility, not of its own will. It wasn't creation's fault that the curse was placed on it. It was because of man's sinfulness. The creation itself, verse 21, also will be set free from its slavery to corruption. Sort of like the second law of thermodynamics there. The slavery to corruption into the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation groans and suffers the pains of childbirth together until now, and the day is coming when that's going to be changed. So the curse is going to be removed. Well, what does that mean anyway? Well, what did the curse bring with it? Well, one of the things that happened was, of course, that the earth became a place that was not so fertile. That's the passage we read this morning in Isaiah chapter 35. One of the promises is that the desert regions are going to blossom and produce. In fact, Isaiah 35 was well known to the nation of Israel. The wilderness and the desert will be glad. The Arabah, that's the Negev region in the south, which if you've been there is just barrenness. It's going to blossom like crocus, blossom profusely. It's going to be like Lebanon and on the coastal plains with their fertility and so on. That's what the deserts are going to be like because the curse is going to be removed. By the way, you know, Israel today is an incredibly productive place. They've drained the swamps in the Galilee region. They've established agriculture in the desert. But that's not fulfilling Isaiah 35, as some indicate. This is in the Messianic age. And the reason why this is all going to happen is not Jewish ingenuity. It has to do with the curse being removed. And so you are going to have a planet that is so different. My wife and I will drive from where we live in Phoenix out to LA, and you just wonder, oh, good grief, there are hundreds and thousands of square miles of barrenness. Can you imagine what it's going to be like when this is a fertile area? It's an amazing thing. The animal kingdom. The prophet Isaiah, by the way, is our greatest contributor to what that's going to be like. But this is that famous passage in Isaiah 11. The wolf will dwell with the lamb. The leopard will lie down with the kid. The calf and the young lion, the fatling together. A little boy will lead them. The cow, the bear will graze. Their young will lie down. The lion will eat straw like the ox. The nursing child will play on the hole of the cobra. The weaned child will put his hand in the viper's den. They will not hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain. And by the way, that's not talking particularly about a mountain, but it means kingdom. In all my kingdom, there's going to be no violence anymore in the animal kingdom. We've watched enough National Geographic specials to know that it's dog eat dog out there. It's a violent animal world. That's never the original creation. In fact, you go back to Genesis 1 and all animals were herbivores. They ate nothing but grass and vegetation. That's the way God originally designed it, not this other. And so we are going to have a world that physically is going to be dramatically, dramatically different. The curse is going to be removed. And the result is tremendous productivity in the earth. Isaiah 65 tells us this, that, and I'll not take time to read it, we have it written down there, but it says this, that anybody who doesn't live, if somebody dies at the age of 100, people are going to say, what a tragedy that is. He died so young. But the reality is that people will live throughout the Messianic age. Why? Because Isaiah 35 is clear, the passage we read, there is no going to be no sickness. Can you imagine a world without sickness, disease, deformities? Isaiah chapter 35, the eyes of the blind will be opened and the ears of the deaf will be unstopped. The lame will leap like a deer. The tongue of the dumb will shout for joy. Every blind man in Israel knew that passage in Jesus' day. And Jesus' miracles were not random power displays. Jesus' miracles were sign pointers to what his kingdom was going to be like. Blind people saw. That's why that guy down by Jericho said, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on us. He was claiming a messianic miracle because he believed Jesus was Messiah. And he knows that when Messiah shows up, there aren't going to be blind people anymore. There aren't going to be lame people. Disease is gone from the messianic age. Death is unusual because the only people who die, die under the rod of iron. Those who have been arrogant enough to sin openly against the king and his kingdom. One of the things that is going to change as well, and again, I put the scriptures down, will not take time to read them, but in the tribulation period, you have two great earthquakes that shape the entire crust of the earth's surface. Every island and every mountain are moved out of their places, the text tells us. Zechariah tells us that his feet will stand upon the Mount of Olives, and the Mount of Olives will be split in two. But less familiar is the next statement a little bit further down, that God is going to make that whole area into a large plain, which Ezekiel says is 50 square miles, where the temple and the city of Jerusalem is going to sit. A 10-mile square city of Jerusalem, a 1-mile square temple is going to sit. It's going to be a change in this planet. My guess is, as we look at the early earth, that in the original creation prior to Noah's flood, that the mountains were very low-lying, maybe 3,000 to 4,000 feet. That appears to be the reshaping of the earth again. Tremendous changes. But the greatest changes are not physical. They are spiritual changes. One of the things that will be so different is that the Lord Jesus himself will appear in his glory. We talked about this in the Bible study hour, where we went through some very deep theological waters this morning. But it's clear that one of the things that will be so different is the fact that the Lord Jesus will be there in his glory. We vision him as we've seen him on DVD presentations and in The Passion of the Christ and other kinds of movies, where he is seen in as the carpenter of Nazareth, as the great teacher, and so on. I know their works, Isaiah says, their thoughts. The time is coming to gather all nations and tongues, that they shall come and see my glory. We mentioned this morning as well that Jesus took Peter, James, and John up to the Mount of Transfiguration for the purpose of them seeing what he is going to be like in his kingdom. And they saw him transfigured before them. Matthew chapter 17. In Matthew 24 and 25, Jesus emphasized that about his second coming. His coming is a return in power and glory. I've often wondered if nothing else happened, but Satan was taken off the scene, what a beautiful world this would be. For those of us who have forgotten, we have an enemy, and this is not a Star Wars idea of the dark side of the Force or something. We are talking about a person who is incredibly smart and incredibly powerful, is highly organized. As Paul says in Ephesians 6, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against these four tiers of demonic beings who are out to do us harm. The world system is Satan's philosophy. It's not always evil in everything, but it is bent on leaving God out. It's really what secularization is. It is leaving God out. It's not necessarily denying his existence. But Satan is going to be removed, and his world system, his philosophy, is going to be gone. Just think for a moment what that would be like if today Jesus just decided to take Satan, as described in Revelation 20, and throw him into the abyss, where he's locked up, imprisoned, and he cannot influence man anymore. He and his forces, his philosophy would die out. Can you imagine? I mean, can you imagine what television and the internet would be like? It would be that. It would be very different. Because instead of unrighteousness being the order of the day, righteousness, God's standard, will be the determining factor. Isaiah and other prophets talk about this again and again. And I think this is really important, because it says, "But with righteousness he will judge the poor, decide with fairness for the afflicted of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth." That's the idea of total severity when it comes to unrighteous behavior. It is the rod of iron. He deals with unrighteousness immediately, and he deals with it severely. "And with the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked, and righteousness will be the belt about his loins, and faithfulness the belt about his waist." I have a really tough time imagining what that's going to be like, because that's not what we see. That's not what we experience today. Fairness and righteousness and justice are lacking. Even in our own culture, our own American life, it's declining rapidly. But it's going to be restored completely with the coming of the Lord Jesus. And with that, you can see some of the other things. Peace. No more North Koreas or Irans. No more international warfare. No building walls on borders. There's no conflict whatsoever. There's a tranquility that descends upon mankind because man is now rightly related to God for the most part. Joy. Sometimes we think that God is really a killjoy. But in thy presence there is fullness of joy, and at thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore. That will apply to the kingdom of God as well. When's the last time you experienced joy? Well, we know what happiness is, and that usually happens very briefly. We as parents can remember Christmas morning. This is going to be so great. And for the first 8 minutes, it is. And then the kids start taking toys from one another, yelling at one another, and all of a sudden, peace, joy, happiness are gone. Now, we have experienced joy in life and some happiness as well, for which we're grateful. But can you imagine that that's what pervade 24/7 the life of God's people? That's what the kingdom is going to be like. It's an entirely different absence. You haven't experienced that, neither have I. There is going to be a full knowledge of the Lord. There is going to be a fullness of the working of the Holy Spirit. There is going to be a governmental structure, and this is where it begins to come to you and I, in that you and I can be a part of that. It will depend upon our faithfulness here and now. But let me move on because of a time issue. Hopefully you'll go back and just look at some of these wonderful things. When the Lord Jesus comes back, and once that 75-day period between his second coming and the Messianic age occurs, which he purifies and judges, then the Messianic kingdom, the millennium, will begin. As we said in the first hour, and some of you weren't here, but on the day one of the kingdom, there are believers only. And we talked about green people and purple people. Purple people are those believers like you and I who have received Christ, and we have received our glorified bodies. We have the body like Jesus had. It's a body built for living on a new earth. We do not have a sin nature. We will never sin again. We won't desire to sin again. And so we are in glorified bodies. The green people are those people who are believers who have come through the tribulation period alive. They are believers, and so they enter the kingdom of Jesus Messiah. They will reproduce. There will be people who are born in the Messianic kingdom, and they too will need to place their faith individually in Jesus. Some will, and a lot won't, but all will conform to the righteous standards of the kingdom. Now, Gentile nations, this isn't just an Israel thing. The Gentile nations will be there. And if I can find the passage, it's in Isaiah 66. Let me check real quick. It's kind of interesting. Yeah, in Isaiah 66:20, Isaiah talks about the Gentile nations that will be a part of believing Gentiles. These are the sheep that come through the sheep and goat judgments. But listen to this. Did you ever see this before? Isaiah 66:21. I will also take some of them, these Gentiles, for priests and for Levites, says the Lord. There are going to be some Gentiles who are actually going to form part of the priesthood that will exist in the Messianic age. That's sort of interesting, isn't it? But Gentiles will be a part of it. The primacy is on the nation of Israel. And you have the passage in Zechariah 8:21. Again, I won't take time to read it. Zechariah 8:21, which says that in that day, the day of the Messianic kingdom, 10 Gentiles will lay hold of one Jew, saying, take us to the king. Take us to Jerusalem. We want to worship the king. And so instead of being beaten up as they are regularly in the United Nations these days, and have been for years, Israel will be the preeminent nation upon the earth. The church has a special place. I wish that John had told us more about this, but he didn't. This is what we know about what you and I will be doing in the Messianic age. We know that we are married to the Lamb in heaven. Remember the marriage of the Lamb. And remember then in Revelation 19, the shout in heaven is, blessed is the one who is invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Well, what's the marriage supper? It's the kingdom. And Jesus used that as an illustration of his kingdom, a marriage supper, a feast that goes on and on and on. And so the bride, you and I, as part of the bride of Christ, believers in Jesus from this age, return with him. I had someone ask me a couple months back, said, my pastor said that when Jesus comes back at his second coming, that we'll stay in heaven. No. Read Revelation 19. We don't stay in heaven. Have you ever heard of, I suppose it's happened, but I can't imagine. You know, a couple gets married, and the bridegroom goes off on the honeymoon by himself and leaves his wife back home. That's not the way it works. When we are married to the Lamb, we return with him and enjoy the great wedding feast. What will be our place? We are not given details. We do know this. When Peter asked the question, Lord, we have left everything to follow you. What's in it for us? Jesus said this, Peter, you 12 are going to sit upon 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel in my kingdom. So, Peter and the other apostles are the foundation stones of the church, and they are going to have a place of ruling authority in the Messianic age. They will be ruling under David, who will be Prince of Israel, who will be under Messiah. So there's a governmental structure. But Jesus was very clear about this, that to faithful believers, they're going to have a place in his kingdom. Two final things, and then we will be done. The two final things bring us back to ourselves today, because this is all well and good, I think, that we be aware of facts and data, and hopefully you will take some time this week before you forget all about it, and to take a look at these passages of Scripture that describe your future and my future. But there are two great issues that we need to mention before we close, and that is inheriting the kingdom and entering the kingdom. In the most famous passage in all of the New Testament, Nicodemus, a Pharisee, one of the great rabbis of Israel of that day, came to Jesus at night. And Jesus said to him, truly, truly, I say to you, when Jesus says truly, truly, he says, you can bet the farm on this. Unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Then he said, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. The subject is the Messianic kingdom. Nicodemus thought, because I am an observant Jew, I've got a free pass into the kingdom. And Jesus says, no, you don't. You must be born by means of the Spirit. And by the way, in verse 5, when Jesus said, unless you are born of water and the Spirit, the water there is not baptism. It's not natural, birth of a woman, the water sac. It has to do with two ministries of the Holy Spirit. And it should read this way. The translators kind of confused us. Unless one is born of water and the wind, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Spirit should be translated wind. And you said, oh, thank you so much. I have no idea what you just said, but thank you for clarifying this. Well, notice what Jesus said to Nicodemus in verse 10. Are you the teacher of Israel and you don't understand these things? In other words, this is Old Testament truth. What's water and wind? Those are two descriptions of the activities and the ministries of the Holy Spirit. The water is a reference to his cleansing. The wind, or the breath of God, is a reference to his regenerating work. And what Jesus is saying to Nicodemus is, Nicodemus, you're not getting into my kingdom unless you are cleaned up and given new life by the Holy Spirit. You do that and you can enter the kingdom. Now, this happens to hold true today. The great issue is, how do we get to heaven? But we know that that's going to be a temporary stop. How do we get into the forever kingdom of God? The answer is, you must be born by means of the Spirit. Well, how does that happen? Well, we know that, I hope. We place our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, God who became flesh and died on the cross, completely taking care of our sin. We place our faith in Jesus. That's how we're born again, isn't it? That's why Jesus said, this is, a child can get it. My granddaughter, 12 years old, assured me when I talked to her this summer, are you going to heaven, Brianna? Yes, I am. Why? I have asked Jesus to be my Savior. Clear, definitive statement. She's 12. Is she a great theologian? No. But she does understand how you enter the kingdom. I hope that's true of everyone. On the authority of the Word and the Lord Jesus, you enter the kingdom by faith in Him and the work of the Holy Spirit. But there's one other issue, which is germane, and then we're done. And I realize I'm taxing you a bit. And that's inheriting the kingdom. In the Old Testament and the New Testament, there is inheritances offered to God's people. One inheritance comes to us automatically because we are the children of God. Remember how Israel was promised an inheritance in the promised land? Was that true? Yes, it was. Did all Israelites enter the promised land? No, Moses didn't. Why? Because he sinned. And so he did not get that inheritance. And the same truth is found in the New Testament, that we are assured of the fact that we will be with the Lord forever. That's our inheritance. But there is, in fact, a second inheritance that the New Testament talks about beyond the scope of what we can deal with. But it's an inheritance that is given to faithful children of God. The first one comes when we are children of God. The second one, when we are faithful children of God. What happens in 2017 is germane to what happens in the Messianic age. Because Jesus, who loves to give good gifts to his children, would love to give each of us the reward of the inheritance, as Paul says in the book of Colossians, if we are faithful to him. And I trust that as we look at what God provides us for the future, that we will recognize that we have an incredible future ahead of us. But what we do now, in fact, does have a part in what life will be like in the future kingdom of God. Lord, we do thank you that you love us, you care about us, and that we're going back to plan A, that eventually what you designed originally is going to be our experience, and we are so thankful for that. But Father, I pray that we will come to realize that this is true, and that we will certainly focus our lives on serving you while we have a chance, here and now, because of what you've done for us, and even what you offer to us. We pray these things, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.